Okay, so it's a pleasure to introduce today Shimon Kolkowitz. He's a NRC postdoc currently at JILA, which is a joint institute with the University of Colorado and the National Institute of Standards and Technology up in Boulder, Colorado. He's giving our joint colloquium today. He's a faculty candidate in both the Department of Physics and here at Optical Sciences. He got his undergraduate degree at Stanford University, and then he did his PhD with Mikhail Lukin's group at Harvard and graduated in 2015. And he's going to today tell us primarily about some experiments that he's been working on in Junyi's group at the University of Colorado in JILA on these really fantastic precision and things they can do with these optical lattice clocks. So a brief history of time keeping, metrology and quantum simulation with optical lattice clocks. So Shimon, thanks.
Okay, so first of all, thanks a lot, Jason, for the very kind introduction, and I'd also like to thank both the Physics Department and the College of Optical Sciences for inviting me. It's a pleasure to be here and to have the opportunity to tell all of you a bit about the research that we're doing and also some research that I maybe hope to do in the future. I guess I'll sort of start, first of all, by issuing a formal apology to Stephen Hawking, although I doubt he's in the audience for ripping off his title. I also want to say that I'm hoping to keep this very informal, so please, you know, feel free to ask questions if at any time things I'm saying seem unclear or confusing or anything like that. So I'll start with a quick outline. I'm going to start by sort of introducing the idea of timekeeping through a sort of history of timekeeping, giving you some idea of how clocks have developed over the years, and that sort of serves nicely to introduce some of the basic concepts for how we think about clocks and how we keep time and how we quantify how good a clock really is. Then I'm going to tell you a bit about the system that I work on now, which is a strontium optical lattice clock, and the system that I work on happens to currently hold the record for being the most accurate clock in the world, and I'll give you a sense of what that means and what we can do with that kind of accuracy. And then I'm going to tell you a bit about a very specific and kind of interesting application of these clocks, which is using these clocks for quantum simulation. And that might sound a little strange, but I'll try to give you a sense of what that really means. And then I'll conclude by giving some outlook and sort of what I think some exciting future prospects for clocks and where I think this technology is going. So let's start with the timeline of timekeeping. For most of history, the way people kept time was actually very rudimentary, but it still gives you some kind of insight into what we mean when we mean keeping time. So in particular, the way people really kept track of time was just by using some kind of astronomical periodic phenomena. And the best, you know, and most obvious examples of this are either the Earth's rotation around its own axis, which gives us the day, or the Earth's orbit around the sun, which gives us the year and is responsible for seasons and things like that. And so that's a kind of nice way to keep track of time, especially when those are the kind of things that you're worried about, like, you know, when's it going to get dark, or when should I plant my crops, and things like that. But it's still a little bit rough, and so you might want something in between the two, and that's why people use lunar calendars to keep track of sort of months and things like that. But this is not a great way to keep track of time on shorter time scales than a day. So it's hard to kind of, you know, measure physical properties to make physics experiments with timing and things like that using a sundial that looks like this, where it's just split up into 10 segments or something like that. And so the first real modern example of timekeeping was in 1656 when Christian Huygens invented the pendulum clock. And this was building off of work done by Galileo. Galileo was the first person to really explain that the motion of a pendulum was periodic and that it didn't depend actually on the mass of the pendulum or on the amplitude of motion, at least to first order, and rather only depended on sort of the length of the pendulum and gravity. And what you can see is that because this pendulum exhibits this nice periodic oscillation, this gives us a good way to keep track of time, right? All we have to do is, just like counting the days, the Earth's rotation about its axis, we just have some nice periodic phenomena, and by counting the individual cycles, we can keep track of time as long as that phenomena truly is periodic. And so what Huygens came up with was something called an escapement. This is an anchor escapement, and this is a way to count the individual cycles of a pendulum clock. And so using this, he was actually able to make quite accurate clocks. In particular, his clocks wound up being accurate to about 15 seconds per day. And this is really gives you some insight into how we think about how good, you know, how to quantify how good a clock is, in the sense that all you really do is sort of quantify how much time it loses over the amount of time that you've kept time for. So it ends up being a dimensionless number where you divide 15 seconds per day by the number of seconds in a day, and in this case you end up with about 2 × 10⁴. And you can intuitively imagine that if instead Huygens' clock kept time to 1 second per day, that would be sort of 15 times better than this clock. And if it was 1 second per month, then that would be 30 times better than that, and so on. But it turns out this is already, if you ask me, quite impressive, and it's useful for doing some interesting physics. If you're wondering what limited it, it was actually mostly limited by the fact that this period depends on L. And what happens is if temperature changes or the, you know, humidity changes or things like that, whatever the material that forms your pendulum can change its length, and then that will change the period. And so that's what kind of gives rise to this inaccuracy in this particular clock. But this is still pretty good. And one example of how good it was that in 1672, there was a French expedition from Paris to French Guiana, and they were making astronomical observations, so they took one of these newfangled pendulum clocks with them. And what John Rocher, who led this expedition, found was that even though he tried as best he could to account for all of these different systematics and everything, his clock ran 2.5 minutes slower per day in French Guiana than it did in Paris. And so he wrote about this, and it turns out that this was actually the first evidence that the acceleration due to gravity changes depending on where you are on the Earth. So what this actually comes from is the rotation of the Earth causes both a centrifugal force when you're on the equator that kind of counteracts gravity. And in addition, there's also a bulge of the Earth as a result of that centrifugal force, and that takes you further away from the center of the Earth and also reduces the local gravitational field when you're at the equator versus at Paris. And you can see that at Paris, we now know we can make much more precise measurements. The acceleration is 9.81 meters per second squared, whereas at French Guiana, it's 9.77. So that's 4 parts in 10 to the 3. Because of the square root, that ends up giving you a change of 2 parts in 10 to the 3. And because you have a clock that was accurate in 2 parts in 10 to the 4, you can easily measure this. And Newton actually used this as evidence and also sort of, I think, to help develop his sort of theory of classical mechanics and Newtonian gravity. And it's, I don't think it's coincidental that only 14 years after this observation, but also only about 30 years after the invention of the pendulum clock, you have Newton's Principia. In the sense, I think this gives you some sense of how clocks and physics have gone hand in hand. By better understanding physics, by better understanding the motion of the pendulum, Huygens was able to develop the pendulum clock. And you can imagine that it's not surprising it took so long to understand how a pendulum actually works, because they didn't have any clocks to keep track of the period of it in the first place and to actually see that it didn't depend on the amplitude and things like that. And similarly, then, by having better clocks, they were able to measure some pretty interesting physics, like that gravity was changing on the surface of the Earth. And that gave you insight that let you develop this kind of, you know, really groundbreaking new theories. So it turns out that actually after that, clock technology, while it continued to improve, didn't change very much until 1921, when quartz oscillators were invented. These are actually very similar to pendulum in the sense that it's just a simple harmonic oscillator. It's still a mechanical oscillator. But instead of a pendulum, it's actually a tuning fork, and it's made of a piezoelectric material. So that lets you, rather than using one of these mechanical escapement counters, you can instead use an electrical counter and actually count the electrical signals coming out of this piezoelectric material in order to keep track of time. And this was adopted as the time standard by the NBS, which was the National Bureau of Standards, which has now become NIST, where I work. And for a period of time, this was actually the world clock. And as you can see, this is a dramatic improvement in the accuracy of the clock in the sense that we've gone from 2 parts in 10 to the 4, or 15 seconds per day, to 3 seconds per year, or, you know, 1 part in 10 to the 7. So that's quite a bit more accurate of a clock. And the main reason that these quartz oscillators are more accurate is actually because the period is much shorter. And what that ends up meaning is that just like intuitively you can imagine it's easier to keep track of time if you count in seconds instead of counting in days, it's also easier to keep track of time if you count in 30 microsecond increments instead of in second increments, like with the pendulum clock. So just by increasing the frequency of the oscillator here, you can actually make a more accurate clock. So if you plot clock progress all the way from 1656 until 1949, you'll see a kind of exponential but relatively slow exponential improvement in the accuracy of clocks. So this line here corresponds to clock accuracy in this, again, unitless fractional frequency uncertainty, doubling every 16 years or so, which is not bad, but it's not quite Moore's law for clocks. But really, as I said, these quartz oscillators aren't actually that different from the pendulum clocks. And in particular, if you look at how one of these clocks really works, you have some kind of local oscillator, some kind of mechanical device that has periodic motion associated with it. And then you have some kind of counter. It might be an SRS counter, or it might be an anchor escapement. It doesn't really matter. But in both cases, every time I make one of these devices, I might screw up. I might make my pendulum a little bit longer, a little bit shorter. I might cut my quartz oscillator a little bit differently. Some dirt or dust might settle on my oscillator, all of those things are going to change the frequency that my clock ticks at. So that means every time I make one of these, it's going to tick at a slightly different frequency. And so there's one additional component that we need for these clocks, and that's some kind of frequency reference. And what you see is that until the last century, that frequency reference continued to be the same kind of rudimentary frequency reference that we've always used throughout history, which is just astronomical phenomena, such as the day or the year. However, that finally changed in 1955 with the development of the first cesium clock, which was based off of pioneering experiments done by Robbie in NMR. And I really like this article from the New York Times in 1945. I think it really sums up the kind of heart of what makes atomic clocks cool, which says, cosmic pendulum for clock planned, radio frequencies and heart of atoms would be used in most accurate of timepieces. And here you see that not too long after that, just 10 years later, after Robbie said this would happen, you had the first cesium beam clock. And turns out this clock was already an order of magnitude better than the very best quartz oscillators that were sort of ever produced. So this is a slightly different way of making a clock. So let me explain the differences between that and a mechanical clock. In particular, the major difference is you still have a local oscillator, and it can still even be one of these quartz tuning forks. And you still have a counter. But now, rather than using the astronomical phenomena as a frequency reference, instead, you can use an atom. And the idea here is that atoms have these internal transitions. And in particular, for microwave clocks, these are hyperfine transitions in the ground states of either cesium or rubidium. And what you can do is you can take this local oscillator, and you can just apply it to your atom. And if you shine this microwave light on your atom, and it's on resonance, you'll excite your atom from the ground state to the excited state. However, if you do the same experiment again, but your local oscillator happens to have drifted off from resonance with the atom, now nothing happens. Our atom stays in the ground state. So what that means is just by sitting on the edge of this transition here and counting how many atoms end up in the E state versus in the G state, I can feed back on my local oscillator and correct for deviations from the true resonant frequency of the atom. And now I have a clock where, as long as I have access to cesium or rubidium, I can make the same clock everywhere in the universe in principle. So this is kind of a universal frequency reference. And the other nice thing is it's also something I can actually measure in the lab, as opposed to the day, which is kind of a hard thing to have access to. This is something I can actually construct in the lab and use to keep time. Of course, this is a quantum process here, this measurement of whether you're in E or G for each individual atom. And we know that you can't actually measure both E and G at the same time. When we make a measurement of the internal state of the atom, we're going to project it into either E and G. So every atom is going to go through a kind of quantum coin flip. And what that means is that there's some fundamental quantum noise associated with this measurement, and I can write that down. And that's called atom projection noise. And this gives me the fractional frequency instability for an atomic clock, accounting only for this fundamental quantum projection noise of this measurement. And this equation really tells you a lot about how to make a good clock. So in particular, you can see that intuitively you might understand you'd like to have the narrowest possible transition, and that's because I want to sit on the edge and I want to be as sensitive as possible to deviations from that frequency. I'd also like to have cold atoms. And the reason for that is because if I don't have cold atoms, I'll get Doppler shifts of the atomic frequency due to the finite temperature of the atoms and the motion of the atoms relative to the light I used to probe them, and that's going to broaden out my transition and make my clock worse. I'd also like to have a lot of atoms, and that just means I get to do more of these quantum coin flips, and I get more signal to noise. So that ends up meaning that I do much better the more atoms I have. I'd like to have long interrogation time so that I can actually truly take advantage of the narrow line width of these atoms and not be Fourier limited by the length of my measurement instead. I'd like to have short dead times, and that's because this M here is the repetition number of repetitions that I do of my clock measurement. So the more times I get to actually measure, the better I do. And if I have to, you know, spend a bunch of time preparing my atoms between each subsequent measurement, that's just going to hurt the accuracy of my clock. And finally, the one thing that this equation doesn't really describe is I need to have well-isolated atoms to avoid systematics. So that's not captured by this equation. This just describes the statistical noise of my clock. But of course, just like Huygens' pendulum clock had issues with temperature changing and that leading to the length of the pendulum changing, if there's any environmental changes that cause the transition frequency of my clock to change, that's also going to change the rate that my clock ticks at, and I need to keep track of that. And I need to be very careful to keep my atoms well isolated and to keep them in a very well-controlled environment. So with the invention of atomic clocks, you can see that the rate at which clocks improved increased dramatically. In particular, now things went from accuracy of clocks doubling every 16 years to the accuracy of clocks doubling every 2.5 years or so. And this gives access, just like Huygens' clock gave access to new physics, these atomic clocks give access to really nice new physics. So one of my favorite examples of that is the Halfley-Keating experiment from 1972. And what Halfley and Keating realized was that clocks in the 1970s had just reached the point where they were becoming sensitive to the effects of relativity on an airplane. So what that really means is that Einstein's theory of special relativity tells you that time should actually dilate based on what velocity your clock is in, and that's the special relativistic time dilation term here. And his theory of general relativity also said that there should be a gravitational redshift depending on how far, how high you are in a gravitational potential, and that will give you some change in the rate of clock ticks as well. And it turns out that both of these effects on a 747 flying, you know, 7 miles above the ground at 500 miles per hour are at the 10 to the minus 12 level. And clocks had just gotten to the 10 to the minus 13 level, and that meant that you could now measure this. So they did this experiment. They actually put an atomic clock on an airplane. They bought first-class tickets for themselves and one extra first-class ticket for the clock. And they flew around the world to the west and around the world to the east, so with the Earth's rotation and against the Earth's rotation, and that's because the Earth itself is actually not really an inertial frame, so you have to kind of account for that. And they left one clock on the ground, and then they compared these clocks, and they were able to actually observe both the special relativistic and general relativity gravitational redshift shifts on the rates that the clock ticked. So this kind of confirmed Einstein's theory of general relativity, and this experiment is kind of famous because in total it cost about $8,000, so it's considered the sort of cheapest experiment to test general relativity. It turns out that these effects are actually quite relevant to our day-to-day lives. In particular, you actually have to take into account both the special relativistic time dilation and the gravitational redshift when using GPS, because these satellites are quite sensitive to it, and GPS would drift off by a kilometer every day or so if you didn't account for these effects of relativity. So this is one of the nice daily applications of atomic clocks that at this point we all take for granted. But I think another really important application that maybe gets slightly overlooked is that of unit definitions. And in particular, we've gotten so good at measuring time that in the new SI, which is just currently being adopted by the International Bureau of Weights and Measures, which is the sort of international organization in charge of defining units, it turns out that all of the units are defined with respect to constants, which are now just defined. So these are no longer things that you can measure. These are just numbers that we've chosen and defined and set in stone. And the hyperfine transition of the cesium ground state. So what that actually means is that you can only really measure all of these units with respect to the second. And the extent to which we can measure the second accurately determines the extent to which we can measure all other units. So what this really means is that there's always motivation, in my mind at least, to build better clocks, because it just determines how well you can really measure anything. So with that in mind, we can take a look at this atomic clock progress just looking at atomic clocks from 1949, which is when the first ammonia maser was built, all the way until 2012. And you can see that sort of clock progress for beam clocks at least sort of started to slow down in the in 1980s, 1990 or so. But fortunately, laser cooling was developed around that time, and that allowed for the construction of cesium fountain clocks, which continued to improve. But again, if you kind of squint at this, you can see it's sort of starting to flatten out, and that is indeed the case. We're sort of hitting the limits for what we can do with these microwave atomic clocks. So now we need to introduce, if we want to keep improving things, some kind of new technology, and that's optical lattice clocks. So it turns out that I conveniently skipped over one of the terms in this equation when I was explaining how to make a clock better, and that's the same term I already told you about, which is the frequency here in the denominator. As I said, quartz oscillators, actually the main reason they're better than pendulum clocks is just because you count with a faster frequency. And so the obvious thing to do is to increase the frequency of the atomic transition that we're using to keep track of time, and that's going to allow us to improve the fractional frequency and stability of our clock. So if we just move from microwave frequencies like 10 gigahertz up to optical frequencies like hundreds of terahertz, we can, in principle, looking at this equation, all other things being equal, improve clocks by 5 orders of magnitude. Of course, that's kind of an obvious idea, and it's not that people were dumb to not think of this before. The problem was actually that there was kind of an enabling technology that did not exist until recently, and that's the laser frequency comb. So the problem is that optical frequencies, 400 terahertz, are much faster than any of the electronics that we can build, and that means it's actually very difficult to actually count the cycles of an optical transition. You can't count all of the individual peaks and troughs when a laser is going by. And so that was the case until the laser frequency comb was developed, and this is related to work going on here in the Jones group, for example, in the College of Optical Sciences. And what the frequency comb really allows you to do, and this is all I'll say about it, is to act as a kind of gear reducer, to go down from optical frequencies to microwave frequencies without sacrificing accuracy. So this is really a kind of optical escapement, a way to count the cycles of optical light. And now we can switch from microwave transitions to optical transitions and really take advantage of this boost by a factor of 10 to the 5. And so that's what we've done. Our atom of choice is strontium 87, which is a fermionic isotope of strontium. And one of the reasons that we choose strontium is because that it has two valence electrons. And I'll just say that this kind of little slogan of two is better than one, I'll return to towards the end of my talk. But in this case, all it means is that having two valence electrons gives you access to both singlet and triplet states and intercombination transitions between the singlet and triplet manifolds. That extra complexity of having two valence electrons rather than one ends up both being a blessing and a curse in the sense that the level structure is quite a bit more complicated. You have to do more work in order to cool these atoms down. But once you've gotten them under control, you now have access to intercombination transitions like this one, which is a doubly forbidden transition between the 1s0 singlet state and the 3p0 triplet state, where you have a 1 millihertz line width transition at optical frequencies, which corresponds to a quality factor of this transition of 10 to the 18, which is really kind of truly remarkable. And so this is the transition that we're going to use for our clock. But in order to take advantage of this 1 millihertz line width, again, we need to make sure our atoms are cold, or else this transition is going to be Doppler broadened. So what we do is we take advantage of some of these other nice transitions offered to us by the strontium level structure and do two stages of Mach cooling, first on this strong allowed transition in the blue, and that allows us to, by doing two stages of cooling in a magneto-optical trap, we get down to 2 millikelvin. Sorry, that's the first stage only. And this is what atoms look like in our blue Mott here. It's quite pretty to actually see. And then we can do a second stage of cooling on this narrower transition here and get down to 2 microkelvin. And 2 microkelvin is quite cold. It's, you know, 2 millionths of a degree above absolute zero. But it turns out that if you do the math, that's still not nearly cold enough because that still corresponds to a 40 kilohertz Doppler broadening of our transition, and we're trying to take advantage of a transition that has a 1 millihertz line width. So we need some other trick. And for that, we borrow from techniques that were originally developed in trapped ions to make trapped ion optical clocks, which is to strongly confine the atoms. Because we have neutral atoms, we can't use the same kind of confinement with electric fields that they use for ions. So instead, we actually use light. And we create a standing wave of light, an optical lattice. And that's where the optical lattice and optical lattice clock actually comes from. And the way we do that is we just interfere two counterpropagating laser beams to form the standing wave, where the confinement in the radial direction just looks like a dipole trap, but the confinement in the axial direction is determined by this interference term that gives you this kind of stack of pancakes with atoms trapped on each individual pancake. And for each of these individual atoms, this pancake along the direction of the axis of this optical lattice trap looks like a harmonic oscillator, basically. So now we have quantized motional levels for this atom. And what that means is that you can enter this what's known as resolved sideband regime, where now the motion can only take quantized amounts of this harmonic oscillator frequency. So that means that my carrier transition, which corresponds to not changing emotional quanta, is right here, and it's well separated from my motional sidebands, which correspond to either going up or down one quanta. And so this allows us to kind of freeze out the motion of the atom so that we don't have to worry about its finite temperature anymore, and now we can really take advantage of its narrow line width. Of course, in doing so, we've introduced a new problem, which is that we're trapping it in a very strong potential, and so those of you who are familiar with atomic physics might worry about the perturbations of this strong sort of optical field that we're applying to the energy levels of our clock transition, because now if what that means is if my lattice intensity changes at all, it's going to change the frequency of my clock transition, and it's not going to be a very good clock. There's a nice solution to this, which is to use what's known as a magic wavelength trap. And what that corresponds to is even though these two clock states, the singlet state and the triplet state here, have different polarizabilities, we can find a point where they cross. And at this point, this doesn't mean that the two energy levels aren't shifting around. They're still shifting around because this polarizability is not zero. But rather, it means that at this particular lattice wavelength, the two levels are shifting around together. So the energy difference between them doesn't change, and it no longer depends on the intensity of the light that we use to trap them. And so using this trick, we can now finally confine our atoms strongly and take advantage of their very narrow line width transition. So you might think we're all set, but then looking at it, you realize, well, now I need some nice local oscillator, something equivalent to my quartz oscillator that I had before. But now I need it at 430 terahertz. So I need an optical frequency, and of course this is a laser. But you realize that, well, I have this 1 millihertz line width, and now I want to probe that with a laser. I'm probably not going to be limited by this 1 millihertz line width. I'm going to be limited by my laser line width instead. So for that, we need to do a very good job of stabilizing our laser that we use to probe this transition. And for that, we've built a 40-centimeter ultra-stable, ultra-low expansion glass. That's what ULE stands for, cavity. The reason for this 40 centimeters is that the sort of frequency of this cavity depends on sort of the length. And so the longer I make it, then small perturbations in the length will matter less and less. And what you want to do is design this cavity so that it's not sensitive to vibrations, to accelerations of the cavity. So a lot of careful work went into designing it so that it was, the length was in principle insensitive to shaking. And also, especially, you want it to be insensitive to temperature. Because even though this is ultra-low expansion cavity, it still has some coefficient of thermal expansion. And so just like Huygens, we're still worrying about exactly the same problems of the temperature changing and then the frequency of our local oscillator changing as a result. So what we do is we do a lot of both active and passive shielding of this cavity so that in the end it has a thermal time constant of days. Meaning if you actually change the set point of the kind of active plate that we use to temperature stabilize this cavity, it takes a couple of days before the temperature re-equilibrates, which means it's really insensitive to what's going on in the outside environment. And doing this, we're actually able to make a stabilized laser with a line width of 26 millihertz, which corresponds to a quality factor of 2 times 10 to the 16. Or if you want to think about it in terms of the stability of the length of this 40-centimeter cavity, that corresponds to, on average, the length of the cavity changing by at most 10 to the minus 16 meters, which corresponds to 1/10 of the radius of a proton, which to me is really staggering that you can actually build things that stable. So this entire cavity, on average, there can be smaller fluctuations that are within the beam spot, but on average, the sort of overall beam spot that you sample, the overall length of this cavity never changes by more than that over on relevant timescales. For those of you who work with lasers, another way to quantify this is with a coherence length, and it turns out that the coherence length of this laser is enough for 10 round trips to the moon and back, which I think is again, another just kind of almost mind-boggling number. Okay, so now we finally have all of the parts of our optical lattice atomic clock, and we can use it to actually do clock spectroscopy. So here you see, for those of you who are familiar, either Rabi spectroscopy, this is doing a pi pulse and sweeping the frequency of the pi pulse across the resonance, or Ramsey spectroscopy, and you see nice Ramsey fringes here. And you can see that we can get quite narrow line widths, even in principle for very long Rabi pulses here, down to 500 millihertz or so. And so this is our really nice clock. And you think, you know, now, okay, finally let's sort of measure how good this clock is. But there's one missing part, which is that now we claim to have built the world's best clock. And unfortunately, there's nothing to compare it to if you do that. So it turns out you actually have to build two of these things. And so that comes back to this kind of idea of two is better than one. We have two of these strontium optical lattice clocks sitting side by side at Jilla in our lab. And we can compare them to each other. And so using that, that's a good way to characterize how stable they are. And you can see that after 10 to the 4 seconds of averaging down the comparison between the two clocks, we reach a fractional frequency uncertainty of now here 3 times 10 to the minus 18. And we've since achieved 2 times 10 to the minus 18. Of course, this is only the statistical uncertainty, because you're just comparing these two clocks to each other. You also have to worry that you know the absolute frequency of both clocks. And that requires a kind of heroic systematic evaluation, which took place before I joined the group. But you can see that a lot of work went into evaluating all of the different possible systematics. And you don't have to pay attention to these individual numbers, but you can just take my word for it that there's a lot of thought and a lot of data taking that went into understanding all of the different possible systematic shifts of the clock frequency so that in the end, we could kind of put confidence levels of 2 times 10 to the minus 18 on the systematic uncertainty. So now we have both 2 times 10 to the minus 18 for statistical and 2 times 10 to the minus 18 for systematic. And so now if you look at clock progress since the development of optical lattice clocks, that corresponds to sitting down here at 2 parts in 10 to the minus 18. And what this corresponds to now is a clock that can keep time to better than 1 second over the age of the entire universe. So it turns out that there's about a little bit less than 10 to the 18 seconds in the entire age of the universe, and so that really means that we can keep time that well. And that's truly kind of incredible to me. What that actually means is now we can go from Halfley-Keating's experiment of measuring relativity on an airplane to relativity in the lab. Whereas they were measuring effects at 10 to the minus 12, it turns out if you look at effects at the 10 to the minus 16 level, for example, that corresponds to lifting your clock up by 33 centimeters, and this was an experiment done by the Dave Wineland's group at NIST, where they literally jacked up their optics table of one of their single ion clocks by a foot, and they were able to see the change in the frequency that the clock ticked at. And to me, this is incredible, because now what this is telling you is that your head is slightly older than your feet, right? So I think the other way to think about this, and this is, if you're a pessimist, you would say, well, now what this is telling you is, if I want to compare two clocks to each other, I better know their altitude, their height, you know, from the center of the Earth to the level of a foot, which is kind of troubling in some sense. So it depends if you want to look at this as kind of a bug or a feature. And now I'm going to tell you a little bit about another example of that, which is kind of trying to turn one of the bugs in our optical lattice clock into a feature. And so that's doing quantum simulation with a clock. So in particular, it turns out that one of the sort of dominant systematics that we have to worry about is the density shift, which corresponds to interactions between these atoms that are sitting on a single pancake. They collide with each other, and that ends up both shifting, but also, more importantly, broadening the clock transition that we look at. So that even though I told you this transition should be a millihertz wide, and we have a 26 millihertz laser to probe it, we only ever see in our clock about 500 millihertz at best line width, and that's because of broadening due to these atomic interactions. And this was actually kind of disappointing, because for the first few measurements with strontium optical lattice clocks, they didn't see any collisional shifts or broadenings. And it was only when they got down to about this 10 to the minus 16 level that these collisions started to matter. And it turns out that it's kind of subtle reasons why these collisions do matter, because these are spin-polarized fermions. In principle, to first order, they shouldn't really be able to collide with each other, because their poly-exclusion principle prevents them from being in the same place. But it's sort of the higher order P-wave interactions as opposed to S-wave interactions that end up giving rise to this, to these shifts. And so a lot of work had to go into understanding these shifts, which are at the 10 to the minus 15, 10 to the minus 16 level, in order to get a systematic uncertainty down at this 10 to the minus 18 level. So there were many studies done in the E group and elsewhere, but primarily in the E group, looking at understanding these many-body interactions. And because these are sort of fundamentally quantum interactions that are governed by quantum statistics, it's actually kind of subtle in order to understand how they actually work. And over time, this went from kind of being a bug to a feature, in the sense that people realized that these interactions are actually quite interesting, and maybe we can use them for quantum simulation. So maybe we can really look at this interesting quantum many-body physics, because now we're becoming sensitive to it. So rather than viewing it as kind of a limitation for our clock, let's take advantage of it. And so the experiment that I'm going to tell you about is moving from the regime, which up until now was the case, which is suppressing tunneling so that the atoms always sit on an individual one of these pancakes. Now I'm taking kind of a slice through the pancakes to just look at it in one dimension. And up until now, we've been in a always operated these clocks in a regime where these atoms cannot tunnel. So what that means is all of the interactions are just on-site interactions. But this is kind of a shame if you want to think about this clock as a quantum simulator, because we have this beautiful optical lattice, and we're just kind of treating it as a bunch of harmonic oscillators that are totally separate from each other. And when you think about it, this optical lattice actually looks a lot like the lattice in a crystal or solid. And of course, you know, there's many other groups around the world using optical lattices to simulate the kind of physics in a condensed matter system. So what we decided to do was basically try to open that degree of freedom up. So in particular, here I've put what I would come up with as my sort of quantum simulation wish list, which is the kind of properties that you might have or you might want if you're going to simulate interesting condensed matter physics. And so you'd like to probably have charge, because a lot of the, you know, properties of materials are determined by electrons, which have charge and, you know, are altered when they move in magnetic fields and things like that. You'd like to have interactions, because this gives rise to a lot of exotic physics. You'd like to have a spin degree of freedom, just like electrons, and you'd also like to have motion. And so when you look at it, you know, the interplay between all of these different kind of features and properties of materials can give rise to all kinds of really fascinating and interesting physics. And up until now, we've restricted ourselves to sort of, in a clock, having spin and interactions. Spin, where here this is sort of a pseudo-spin that we can use for simulation, where we use the clock levels as an effective spin. But there's also the nuclear spin, which you can use for simulation as well. But we up until now, have not taken advantage of motion. And because we have neutral atoms, we don't really have charge. So let's do something about that. And as my advisor said, set the atoms free. Let's allow them to tunnel and move around so that now we can really, you know, put a check mark on this motion in our quantum simulation wish list as well. And when we do that, you might wonder what the sort of interesting physics to look at. And I think the clear kind of first example is spin orbit coupling, where this gives rise to all kinds of interesting physics in condensed matter, like topological insulators, for example, which are conducting on the edge states of the 3D material but insulating on the bulk. And that's known to be a result of spin-orbit coupling, and this can also give rise to more exotic physics in the presence of interaction. So let's try to simulate spin-orbit coupling as a kind of first step in the direction of using these clocks for quantum simulation. So the way to do that is to now, as my advisor said, set the atoms free. And the way we do that is delocalizing the atomic wave function. So what we do is we just turn down one of these retro beams so that we go from being in a deep lattice to being in a shallow lattice. And when we do that, our atom now is no longer described by these harmonic oscillator levels localized on a single site, but rather it's delocalized, so it's instead described by block bands. And, you know, for those of you from the condensed matter community, this looks a lot like the band structure that you have in solids. So this gives you a sense of why this is kind of a nice system to actually simulate a condensed matter system. So we have now motion. What about the spin? Well, as I said, the spin is just a pseudo spin where the spin up or spin down is just given by either being in the E clock state or the G clock state, this singlet or triplet state. So what that ends up looking like is we fill these bands up with atoms because we have many atoms. It turns out that our system's only quasi-one-dimensional in the sense that there's still the radial modes, and that allows you to have many atoms even though they're all fermions and, you know, they can't all occupy the same state because there are many different motional states in the radial degree of freedom. You can really fill this band up entirely with atoms. And so we have we load our atoms into the ground band of the lattice, and we have atoms in both G and E. And we can apply a clock laser to drive atoms from the G state to the E state. And it turns out that just that measurement, which is what we always do when we're measuring our clock, is enough to give you spin-orbit coupling. And I'll explain how now. So because we're in a magic wavelength lattice, if you look at the ground band of the lattice for both the G and the E state, they have identical dispersion relations. These are the two block bands for the G and E state, and they're just separated in energy here by the energy of the clock transition itself, this H bar omega A, right? So now if we apply a clock laser on resonance with an atom with a specific quasi-momentum here, you can see that momentum conservation, because there's some, in order to excite the atom from G to E, you have to absorb a photon from the clock laser, and that has some momentum associated with it. You have to, in order to conserve momentum, you have to change quasi-momentum by this ratio between the wavelength of the lattice and the wavelength of the clock laser. And so in order to make the math simpler for ourselves, what we can actually do is move to a sort of different system where our Hamiltonian is diagonal with respect to quasi-momentum just by shifting this upper band over by exactly that amount, this lambda L over lambda C. So I haven't actually done anything here. This is just a math trick to make my math easy. But now quasi-momentum is kind of conserved for these transitions. And you can see that going from G to E just corresponds to making this transition from this ground sort of state to this excited state with these shifted bands with respect to each other. And if I move to the rotating frame and shift this down on top of each other just by sort of eliminating out the frequency of the photon itself, you see that I now have spin orbit coupled bands, where my bands are actually now split by the Rabi frequency that I of my clock laser that I use to drive this transition. And what sort of now governs the kind of physics of this Hamiltonian is that spin and momentum are coupled to each other. They're locked to each other. So what that means is depending on the quasi-momentum I have, the Q, which is a good quantum number, I now will kind of either be sort of, if I'm in this band, mostly in the G state or mostly in the E state or in some kind of mixture of G and E. And so the way to describe this is the Hamiltonian for this system, is just my standard sort of Rabi oscillation term here, but an additional magnetic field that depends on my quasi-momentum. And so this is a spin-orbit coupled system that's described by these what are known as chiral block vectors, where depending on what quasi-momentum I have, which is color-coded here, you can see, and what band I'm in, then the motion of the system in the block sphere, so this sort of, you know, this is just spin up or spin down, will be precession around these vectors. So that's the physics that I want to look for. Having said that, I'll say that this is a kind of physics that a lot of people in the cold atom kind of quantum simulation community simulate, and they have a kind of different language to talk about this physics. So in particular, they often use the language of synthetic gauge fields, which corresponds to kind of switching my spin degree of freedom for a charge degree of freedom. And so I'll just quickly introduce that because that is how this is often talked about in the literature, which is to say that it's the physics, rather than the physics of a kind of spin-orbit coupled system, it's instead the physics of an electron where now we don't worry about its spin anymore, a charged electron moving around on a two-dimensional lattice with magnetic field threading through it so that you have this flux phi inside of these plaquettes. And that's the kind of physics that gives rise to this nice Hofstadter butterfly, for example, and the quantum Hall effect and things like that. And you can see that the two are equivalent just by looking at our system, and instead of treating this G and E state as a spin, as a pseudo spin, we can instead actually treat it as a kind of synthetic dimension, so that we have the real dimension of what side on the lattice I happen to be sitting at, and the synthetic dimension of am I in G or E. And it turns out that now, sort of an atom that moves around in this synthetic two-dimensional ladder actually behaves just like an electron that's experiencing this magnetic field with flux phi. So we've basically traded having a spin degree of freedom for having a charge degree of freedom, which is really nice because a lot of these condensed matter systems rely on these kind of, a lot of condensed matter physics relies on having charge. And if we want to now eventually add spin back in, we do have access to these nuclear spin states as well because we're using a fermionic isotope. And so in principle, we could do a quantum simulation where we have both the kind of charge and spin. But we're not going to do that today. So this is not a new idea. It's actually been done before in other cold atom systems. But up until now, that's always been done with these kind of Raman transitions between hyperfine states in alkali atoms. And it turns out that that gives rise to some problems like heating and decoherence from the sort of excited state that you use in order to couple these two ground states. It's also the case that all of these measurements up until now have been kind of characterized using time of flight measurements, where at the end of your experiment, whatever you do, you release the atoms and watch them fly apart, and that's how you kind of characterize the spin orbit coupling. And that's an inherently kind of destructive measurement. You can't really do that in situ. So if you want to watch dynamics on the fly, you might want to have a different way to probe it. So in contrast, our clock implementation, while it's quite a bit hotter in the sense that we're using thermal fermions, where these are experiments always done with degenerate gases, we have this very nice long-lived optical transition that's going to form our spin state or our synthetic dimension. And that means we don't have to worry about this heating and decoherence from spontaneous emission anymore. And in addition, we also can take advantage of having this really nice narrow transition and narrow clock laser in order to do in situ precision clock spectroscopy. And so that's the tool that we're going to use rather than time of flight measurements in order to characterize this physics. So let's actually do the experiment now. So as I told you, we start with atoms that are strongly confined in our lattice. And here you see this, again, really nice Rabi line shape of our clock transition for a large confinement. But all we do now is turn down our axial confinement, and something very weird happens to our clock transition. You see that it kind of broadens out quite dramatically, and it actually splits into two peaks. And it's a little bit hard to see, but if we zoom in on, for example, this point at very low confinement of, you know, a 7E recoil here, you see that these peaks are actually quite sharp. And our transition has gone from being a sort of hertz-level transition to a kilohertz broadened transition with two kind of weird-looking peaks. And actually, when I saw this, I was really confused initially. But it turns out you can actually understand this already with the physics that I introduced and adding one extra component in, which is the density of states. So it turns out that when you're looking at this dispersion relation or this dispersion curve for our atoms in the ground band, not all quasi-momenta are created equal. The density of states actually scales with the derivative, the inverse of the derivative of this dispersion curve. So what that ends up meaning is that atoms like to sit on the turning points here, and there's fewer atoms sitting on the sharp slopes of this dispersion curve. And so that's actually all you need to understand this line shape, because now if you consider what happens when I try to drive a transition from this ground band to this excited state band, if I'm off resonance here to the left, I can't drive any of my atoms up to this excited band. As soon as I'm on this left peak here, I'm driving atoms from the top of this ground band, which has a turning point there, so there's a lot of atoms there, up to the bottom of this other band, which also has a turning point there, so my atoms are kind of happy to do that transition. So you have to consider the joint transition density of states, and that's why this peak is rather sharp and there's more atoms getting excited. Okay, so I can drive these atoms up like that. Now if I sit somewhere in the middle of this split line shape, that corresponds to trying to drive atoms in the end that are sitting on the slopes here up to the slopes up here. And so some atoms will get excited, but a lot fewer than we're at this turning point. And finally, if I'm driving over here to the blue side of my transition, so I'm off resonance now to the blue, higher energy, I'm actually driving atoms from the ground, bottom of the ground band to the top of this band. And so that's what gives rise to this kind of split peaks. And it turns out that this is a really nice way to actually kind of map out our band structure, because now, because of this, the height of this band is given by 4J, where J is the tunneling rate for atoms on this lattice, I can actually use this to measure tunneling in my lattice, which is not a number that people generally have access to in these optical lattices. In addition, it turns out that these peaks, these divergences in the density of states that happen at these turning points, are actually well known in condensed matter systems, and they correspond to some, they're called Van Hove singularities. And you actually see them in the optical absorption spectra of solids, and you also see it in the when you do STM measurements of the density of states of electrons in a solid. So this is kind of, we're getting access to condensed matter physics that, at least as far as we're aware, have never before been observed with cold atom systems. Not that they weren't present, but just that our particular way of measuring it gives us access to this physics, whereas other ones are not well suited for it. And as I said, you can actually now use this, because the splitting between these two Van Hove singularities is given by 8J, we can actually use this to actually measure the tunneling rate in our lattice, which is also quite nice. And just to give you sort of a sense of how similar this is to what people see in condensed matter systems, this is an STM measurement of bilayer graphene showing you Van Hove singularities for their particular band structure. And you can see that it actually looks quite similar to the sort of split line shapes that we see in our system. So this is quite nice, because what this sort of split line shape here lets us actually do is select out some particular quasi-momentum and prepare it so that we can actually study the spin-orbit coupling. So the way we do that is just by exciting with our clock laser tuned to one of these Van Hove singularities, for example, and then blowing away all the remaining ground state atoms. And now we only have atoms prepared with this particular quasi-momentum. And now we can do experiments with them. And you can see that if we just take spectroscopy of those atoms, now our line shape looks like this really funky asymmetric line shape, because there's only atoms with this quasi-momentum left. And that allows us to actually probe the spin-orbit coupling physics, because now we can prepare atoms with one particular block vector and watch it process. And that's the experiment that we do. So what we actually do is we select out atoms by just driving first with a weak pulse at one of these colored arrows. Then once we blow away the remaining atoms, we can just drive again with a strong clock pulse, which generates these spin-orbit coupled bands, where now we're kind of preparing these slices of quasi-momentum that I've color-coded to these arrows, and that corresponds to moving, I'm sorry for the lousy resolution here, but that corresponds to moving around these block vectors, processing around these block vectors with different angles depending on what quasi-momenta I prepared. And so here's, you can actually see data from the experiment, and here I show you kind of what that actually looks like with this kind of rotation sped up. But you can see that we get different Rabi oscillation frequencies with different amplitudes for the different quasi-momenta that we prepare corresponding to these different block vectors. And this is really the sort of smoking gun signature for spin-orbit coupling in our system. So sure enough, now we've actually realized the spin-orbit coupling that we set out to do. And this is, that's sort of the end story of the story for the work that was, that I just told you about, which was published actually today in Nature. What's kind of funny about this whole story is I told you I motivated this to start with, that we wanted to look at interactions, right? And that's kind of what kicked this whole thing off. And so far, everything we've looked at is single particle physics, because it's already kind of difficult to get a handle on. But now that we understand it, we're moving towards actually combining this spin-orbit coupling with interactions. And the first thing that we want to look at and what's the experiments currently going on in the lab is studying Kondo-like physics, so Kondo lattice-like physics that I think is actually quite exciting direction to go in. So that's the work that I've done for my postdoc. But I'd like to tell you a bit now about where I think things are going and what I'm really excited about doing with clocks going forwards. So if you look at the progress that clocks have made as a function of time again, and you kind of project it forwards, just draw a line through it. Again, as I said, clocks have been improving or doubling in accuracy about once every 2.5 years or so. And I don't think that there's really any fundamental reason to think this is going to stop. In fact, if you look at how this has progressed up until now, every time we kind of develop a new clock technology, the rate that clocks improve increases, not decreases. So there's not really reason to think this is going to saturate. And if you're interested later, I can tell you about some of the technologies that I think will continue to push this improvement going forward. But as you start to get to lower and lower levels, you'll start to access kind of more and new physics, because now clocks are going to start to reach accuracy, fractional accuracies of 10 to the minus 20, 10 to the minus 21 in just 20 years or so. And that number was suggestive to us because this starts to be the kind of level that we expect to see things like gravitational waves. 10 to the minus 23 is the sort of sensitivity, the sort of strain sensitivity that LIGO operates at, for example. And so we started to think about, are there ways that we can apply these optical lattice clocks to, for example, doing gravitational wave detection? And so here are some of the kind of novel applications of optical lattice clocks that are just starting. There's just starting to be some theory proposals for doing, for example, dark matter detection. Depending on what you think dark matter actually is, it can sort of shift the frequency that these clocks tick at very small levels. And so if you compare clocks around the world, as you move through some clump or cloud of dark matter, you'll start to see the different clocks ticking at different rates. As you move through that dark matter. People are already doing these kind of measurements of the variation of fundamental constants, like the fine structure constant or the electron-proton mass ratio, by measuring and comparing optical lattice clocks with different elements. But I'm going to focus on these two down here, which is gravitational wave detection and tests of general relativity. And so, in particular, I'll start with gravitational wave detection. Of course, you can't talk about that without talking about LIGO. This is, I think, one of the greatest feats of physics, certainly in my lifetime, and I would say ever. But they've now detected gravitational waves. They saw two for sure and one probably. And these are the three different sort of candidates that they observed. And what you can see is that they actually only observe these gravitational waves for at most a couple of seconds. And that's kind of a shame, because people would actually ultimately really like to kind of point telescopes at these merging black holes. But actually, people don't really think you're going to see much from black holes. But there should also be binary neutron star mergers. And people would really like to point telescopes at these binary neutron star mergers to see, for example, if there's gamma ray bursts, because people think that's one of the candidates for what's generating these gamma ray bursts. And LIGO just doesn't see these things for long enough to give you time to point a telescope in the same direction. Of course, if you're lucky and happen to have a telescope pointing there already, great. But what you'd really like is to be able to see them earlier on. And in addition, LIGO's only sensitive in this frequency band from 10 hertz or so, even a bit higher, up to about a kilohertz. And there's other, we believe, sources of gravitational waves at lower frequencies, like massive binaries and extreme mass ratio binary systems. And so for that reason, people have proposed these space-based interferometer missions. So this is LISA and ELISA are basically two different versions of LIGO in space. And the idea is that you can put satellites in space to get away from Newtonian noise, which is actually what limits LIGO sensitivity here. That's just the motion of tectonic plates and tides and everything else on Earth that's actually generating gravitational potential noise that looks a lot like gravitational waves but isn't. So you can get away from that by going to space. Of course, that's quite expensive and hard. But we think it's worth it. And so if you look at these plots, there's actually kind of a gap between LISA and LIGO. And that's the kind of regime that we think atomic clocks, optical lattice clocks, could kind of contribute something to. So in particular, the kind of experiment that we're proposing is very simple, although it would be incredibly difficult and expensive to actually realize. You'd have two satellites separated by quite a long baseline, and each one has an optical lattice clock inside of it. And what you do is you just compare laser light to your optical lattice clock in, let's say, satellite A, and then you send that light over from A to B, and you compare it to the optical lattice clock in satellite B. And if a gravitational wave happens to pass between your two satellites, it's going to move your two satellites with respect to each other, just like it moves the LIGO mirrors and gives a sensitivity on Earth. And so what that's going to result in is a Doppler shift of this laser light that you can measure just by comparing the two clock measurements. And if you time your measurements right, so if you wait to measure in B the travel time, the transit time from A to B, you can actually make a differential measurement where you completely cancel out all of the noise on your clock laser. So you don't even necessarily need a very good clock laser. You don't need these kind of incredible cavities like the ones that we're using in the lab today, and you should still, in principle, be able to sense these kind of very small Doppler shifts as a result of this passing gravitational wave. That on its own would actually give you a kind of different sensitivity curve than LISA. So you can see here that if you just do kind of a standard Ramsey sequence like we use in the lab, you actually would get a different sensitivity scaling than LISA as a function of frequency. But what's really nice is now you can actually change the sequences that you use to measure the clock light. And you can use these kind of sophisticated sequences that are called dynamical decoupling sequences, for example, where rather than just doing a Ramsey spectroscopy sequence, you can apply these periodic pi pulses halfway through. And what this allows you to actually do is lock into a specific frequency and be sensitive to gravitational waves up here at these higher frequencies, where you're no longer kind of limited by the baseline that you've picked for your detector. And that's fundamentally different than what LISA can do. Now, what you've done in doing so is converted your detector from a broadband detector to a narrowband detector. So while LISA is quite sensitive to everything in this range here above this gray dashed curve, our detector is only sensitive to one very specific frequency that you can pick by choosing what sequence you actually apply to the clocks. And so, in principle, you can sweep this around and look for gravitational waves at different frequencies, but at any one time, you're really only looking at one very specific frequency. And so what that ends up looking like is this, where this is now our sensitivity curve for our proposed detector, and you have this kind of narrow band sensitivity that you can tune around throughout this whole range. And in principle, one thing you might think about doing is, say, LISA detects some ongoing merger event, and then it chirps up as the merger gets faster and faster as they get closer and closer together. The frequency chirps up out of the LISA band, but it hasn't arrived in the LIGO band yet. Well, you could use this kind of detector to keep track of it and to keep sensing it as it kind of shifts through, and you can just keep changing your pulse sequence to stay sensitive to it. So we think that's kind of neat. However, if you look at the numbers, you're talking about sort of about two orders of magnitude more strontium atoms per clock than we currently have. and taking full advantage of the coherence time of this transition, which means using, you know, sort of getting rid of these interactions that have been bothering us until now and really taking full advantage of the coherence time of this thing. And so for that, you need some new technologies and you need some technology development. And so one thing I'm interested in doing is just kind of testing if what we're actually proposing is even feasible. So I'm not proposing sending satellites into space just yet. This would require making better clocks than we currently have on Earth and now sending them into space. So I think it's a long way away. But I'd like to kind of test and see, is this even possible? Is what we're proposing possible? And for that, I'm proposing this, what I call multiplexed optical lattice clock, where the main difference, the main twist on what has been done with optical lattice clocks until now is rather than having one lattice, you have two. And that brings us back to this two is better than one idea. And what this really lets you do is do synchronized measurements between these two lattices, these two atomic ensembles, where we can kind of sync up our Ramsey sequences between the two lattices so that you're always probing with the same clock laser light. And all of the laser noise is common mode. All of the environmental noise, like temperature and magnetic fields and everything, is common mode between these two lattices. And you can really see how far you can push things and see if you can really kind of, for example, probe out to the full 160-second coherence time of this clock transition. Another really nice thing is this, and this is getting to the test of general relativity, is now you can use this to make even more sensitive measurements of this gravitational redshift, for example, where now you can imagine having these two lattices side by side and just slightly shifting one lattice up with respect to the other. And now you should be able, if you look at the numbers, to measure kind of the gravitational redshift from centimeter to maybe even millimeter changes in height. Because you're making a differential measurement that rather than an overall measurement. But that's kind of, you know, just making the same measurements we've already made more sensitive. What really excites me is actually testing kind of the Einstein equivalence principle in a new way. So the idea here is we know that from Einstein's equivalence principle, you can't tell the difference between being in an elevator just sitting on the Earth and feeling gravity here and being an elevator on an elevator in space with a rocket strapped to it accelerating you with the same acceleration as the acceleration due to gravity. This is what basically one formulation of Einstein's equivalence principle is. I can't tell the difference between these two scenarios. And what that actually tells me is that there's kind of a twist on this gravitational redshift experiment where now if I make my lattices horizontal, now gravity is going into the slide here. So the lattices are at exactly the same height, but now I accelerate them horizontally at the same exact acceleration so that in principle they're always at the same velocity. You would at least think naively that they're always separated by the same length, although it depends on what frame you're actually thinking about. And now, if your clocks are just separated in space along the axis of acceleration, one of them is going to tick faster than the other. To me, that's really counterintuitive and weird, but that's what Einstein's equivalence principle tells you, and I'd like to measure this. This is an effect that has not been measured before. This is the special relativistic analog to the gravitational redshift. And if you measure both this and the gravitational redshift, you can actually put a limit on how true Einstein's equivalence principle really is. It won't be as sensitive as, for example, the traditional ways that you test this using universality of free fall, which is a test of the weak equivalence principle, but it's actually a test of different assumptions. And so I think it's still quite interesting and exciting experiment to try. I'm going to skip this part and just say another nice aspect of having these two clocks is that instead of doing these synchronized measurements, you can actually interleave the two measurements so that you never have the atoms sitting in the dark. You're always measuring one set of atoms or the other, and this lets you get rid of a kind of pernicious effect called the Dick effect that tends to put a kind of strong limit on how good our optical lattice clocks actually can be. So I think this is another kind of promising application. And finally, I'll just say that I think really long-term, there's some other exciting directions that you can take this kind of research in. For example, thinking about introducing Rydberg interactions between the atoms so that you can even think about generating kind of spin squeezing to do you know, clock measurements below quantum projection noise limit. And with that, I'm going to skip over the sort of very small part I have about doing stuff with solid state defects and just conclude. So I think that hopefully I convinced you that kind of clocks and physics have progressed hand in hand. As we've understood physics better, we've been able to make better clocks. And as we've understood clocks better, we've actually been able to improve our understanding of physics. I had also told you a bit about optical lattice clocks and how they provide kind of a new and unprecedented level of precision and accuracy. And I told you specifically about an experiment we did to simulate some kind of exotic condensed matter Hamiltonians using optical lattice clocks. And finally, I hopefully convinced you that there's some really exciting and unique applications to clocks going forwards. And so with that, I'd like to acknowledge all the people that have worked on the experiments I told you about. And that includes the Strontium-1 team here, which are the people who did the spin-orbit coupling work with me. The Strontium-2 team, which is the team that runs the other clock that we use for clock comparisons. Stable lasers, which are the people that develop and maintain this new generation of ultra-stable cavities. and also the people that I worked with on gravitational wave detection, and of course my PhD advisor, Misha Lukin, and my current postdoctoral advisor, June Yi. Misha's here, June is up here in the sunglasses, looking cool, and with that, I'll thank you all very much for your attention.
Thank you. Open it up for questions.